Hello everyone, and welcome to the last episode of our integration series. In the previous video, we worked on the analytics requirement where we created complex ETL transformations, we developed predictive machine learning models using Azure Synapse Spark and querying using both serverless and dedicated SQL pools. We stored the final results in dedicated SQL pools, which was also known as SQL Data Warehouse. We leveraged the power of integrated Power BI to visualize the enriched data. The final result was an SAP sales dashboard report where we can see important KPIs, for example, top 10 customers by revenue or top 10 materials by volume. With that, I will hand it over to Mahesh, who is going to do a walkthrough on the report. And once the walkthrough is finished, then we are going to look at some of the key strategies, some of the key points for the implementation of integration projects. Over to you, Mahesh.
Hello and welcome. Let's learn how to create beautiful Power BI dashboards and reports from within the Azure Synapse Analytics itself. First, I will show you how to create a Power BI workspace, and then we will link the Power BI workspace with the Azure Synapse workspace so that you can be able to create the Power BI datasets using the data within the Azure Synapse workspace. Then we will publish those Power BI datasets into the Power BI workspace, which will allow us to be able to create the reports within the Azure Synapse workspace itself. In order to create a Power BI workspace, you need to first log into powerbi.microsoft.com into your tenant. Then from the left navigation pane, you can select the workspaces and click Create a Workspace button. It would then launch this navigation pane on the right side of your screen, where I have previously given a workspace name as SAP ASA Project Workspace and given some description. Then, if you want to configure any advanced settings, please feel free to do so by expanding this advanced settings page link. So once you give all the necessary details, click save. This would create a Power BI workspace within your tenant. Once you have created the Power BI workspace from within the powerbi.com, then you need to log into Azure Synapse workspace and then open the Synapse Studio. From within the Synapse Studio, select the Management Hub. Underneath the Management Hub, you would see many options in your left navigation pane. Select the Linked Services and click Create New Linked Service. And then search for the Power BI. Select the Power BI icon and then click Continue. Here, I have previously given my linked service name as Power BI Workspace 1 and given some description. Then it would also populate the tenant. So once you select the tenant, appropriate tenant, you would then see various different workspace names coming from that tenant. Select the previously created Power BI Workspace name here, which would then activate the Create button. Click Create. This would then create the link between the Power BI Workspace and the Synapse workspace. Now that we have successfully created the Power BI workspace and linked it with the Azure Synapse workspace, now let's create a Power BI dataset and publish it to the Power BI workspace. In order to create a Power BI dataset, you need to first log into Azure Synapse workspace and then select the Develop Hub. Underneath the Develop Hub, select the Power BI. Once you expand the Power BI, then you would find the workspace you have previously created and linked. In that, select the Power BI datasets, which would then allow you to create a new dataset. So in my case, I'm clicking on this new Power BI dataset. Then in order to complete this exercise, you need to have Power BI Desktop installed on your machine, folks. I have previously installed the Power BI Desktop, so I can just hit Start button. You would find all the databases associated within your Azure Synapse workspace. However, I'm selecting the SAP ASA SQL pool, which is the database on the SQL dedicated pools. So once I select this database and then click Continue, it would then allow me to download the .pbids file. So once I open the .pbids file using the Power BI Desktop, it might ask you to log into SQL dedicated pools. If so, please do key in your credentials, and once you are successfully logged into the SQL dedicated pools, then you can import the tables into the Power BI desktop. So once the tables are imported, in my case, as you can see, fiscal year balance and then customer total revenue to materials volume, SGA sales. You would then be able to create the reports directly within the Power BI desktop and then publish those reports and dashboards into the Power BI workspace, which would then allow you to create or edit those reports natively within the Azure Synapse workspace itself. Now that we are able to create the Power BI datasets and dashboards and publish those datasets and dashboards into the Power BI workspace, now you can see those reports natively within the Azure Synapse Analytics itself. Inside the Synapse Studio, select the Develop Hub and go into the Power BI, and you can then be able to see those reports natively, as you can see in this page. In my case, I have basically created few visuals such as SGA sales by posting period by selecting the clustered columnar chart, and SGA sales by year by using the line chart. Top 10 customers by revenue using the stacked column chart. Top 10 materials by volume using the stacked bar chart. You can also add as many as slices and filters into your report so that users can slice and dice the data accordingly. You can also add the KPIs such as in this case revenue, which is 89.17 million as cards. So this concludes how easy it is to basically integrate the Power BI workspace into the Azure Synapse workspace and then be able to create the nice visuals and dashboards reports using the Synapse workspace itself, allowing your business users to be able to make data-driven decisions. With that, I would hand it over to Lalit, who would then talk about the key learnings of the SAP and ASA integration, Azure Synapse Analytics integration journey.
As we have seen so far, Azure with Power BI is a powerful platform for analytics solutions. I would like to share some key learnings from customer implementations. Let's start with performance improvements. There are several key strategies you can implement to improve the performance of your solution. Batching and parallelism, for example, instead of one big bang load, not only increases the throughput, it will also help reduce the load on your source system. You can also consider compression of huge data files to reduce the size of the data being ingested. There are other features within Synapse, such as materialized views, result set caching, which can help improve the performance. The next is partitioning, which is a very effective way for maintaining your data by using partition switching or selective partition querying for improved performance. Usual recommendation is not to create too many partitions than needed. For example, try to consider using weekly or monthly partitions instead of daily partitions. That will reduce the number of partitions. Next is to implement incremental loads where possible instead of full loads. Identify and extract only delta records using watermark columns, which is typically a last updated timestamp. These delta records, once identified, can be extracted and merged into your target tables. This will have huge impact and improvement on load times, and hence giving you an ability to refresh large data sets more frequently. Finally, there can be some exceptions and failures in your pipeline. One of the common reasons for failures is issue with your schema and data types. So we recommend always to make sure your source and target schemas are compatible and try to reduce the number of columns where possible to avoid these failure points. There are many features within the Synapse and the Azure platform which can help you debug and troubleshoot these issues as and when they occur. Now, I'm going to hand over to Pankaj to take this forward. Thank you.
Thanks, Lalit, for sharing your experiences. I would like to add my perspective with respect to these key strategies. So the first one is really around performance. It's important to ensure that the data extraction process does not affect the performance of the source system. So one can consider the usage of SAP logon groups so that the connection, which is coming from integration runtime, can connect to specific group of application servers. Now, think about optimization of your SAP RFC parameters. For example, different quotas available. The next point is around extraction of data. So it is quite possible that your SAP table might have billions of rows in it. So think about partitioning this data into smaller partitions using partition option and settings. Now, to speed up the copy process, think about parallel copy. In this case, where, for example, let's say it is parallel copy set to 4. Now, in this case, Azure Data Factory will run 4 different queries based on your partition setting and options. Now, in certain cases, it is quite possible that you might see that a copy activity job waits long in the queue. So in those cases, think about scaling up or scaling out your integration runtime VM. Now, coming to incremental copy, it is quite possible that your data might have a date timestamp. So in that case, you can use the tumbling window trigger, or if it has got an incremental column, then you can use your external control table or file plus high watermark feature. Now we touched a little bit on performance partitioning and incremental copy. And now I would touch on some of the exceptional cases. So let's say if you have a table which has got a column which is not integer, doesn't have any date, calendar, year features, so you are not able to use the partition option. In that case, think about using a custom function module where you can extract data based on lower bound or upper bound of a specific column. So you can define and design your partitions based on those values. The second case would be, how do you handle the failure of pipeline jobs? So you could use a feature like for each, where you can divide a big table into smaller copy data jobs. Let's say, for example, if you have a 10 terabyte of data, you can divide it into 10 copy data jobs. Now, within those copy data jobs, you can have standard partitioning features as well. If something fails at the copy data job level, at the 1 terabyte level, then that can be restarted from the point where it stopped. And if something fails within the specific partition, then that is a complete restart process. With that, I will hand it over to Mahesh for the summary. Thanks for being with us. I hope you have enjoyed the series. Thank you.
To summarize, in this SAP and Azure Synapse Analytics integration series, we have first started with a business scenario, setting some kind of baseline understanding the importance of the SAP and Azure Synapse Analytics integration. In the second session, we have actually walked through the sample reference architecture on how both these systems can integrate and work with each other. Then in the third session, we have actually learned how easy it is to create integrate the data using the Synapse pipelines and transform the data using the mapping data flows and the Synapse Spark itself. Also, we have learned how to create and deploy intelligent models using the Synapse Spark. And some overview on the Azure Machine Learning integration itself. Followed by, we have also reviewed how easy it is to integrate both Azure Synapse Analytics and the Power BI to be able to create the reports and dashboards for your business users to consume the data-driven sort of insights from the SAP data. Along with that, we have also actually walked through the key learnings of the SAP and Azure Synapse Analytics integration journey and the best practices as well. We hope you have all enjoyed this 5-part series, and please do subscribe for new sessions, folks. Thank you.